Welcome to Hope Crossing Community Church. I'm Crystal Clydesty. Thank you, everybody that's here in person or online on Facebook or YouTube joining us in worship this morning. We're glad you're here with us. Pastor Nick is away this morning. He is serving with Life Choices this morning. And let's remember him this morning in prayer. As he's doing life for life choices in the pregnancy center for our community. Also, just a quick reminder that there will be a mailing going out this week to everybody that's in our database, and it will outline our future plans for men, women, and everybody else in our church family growth group options. So this would include Saturday options for the men and the women, and then also Wednesday night option for anyone in our church family, young, old, single, married, everyone. And then also it will include an outline option of anyone who wants to join our church family online who cannot meet in person. But we can send you a letter. Or we cannot send you a letter if you haven't filled out either a connect card like this here in person. You can fill one of these out. They're in the hallway, and you can put it in the basket with your contact information. And also, people that are joining us online, you can fill it out at hopecrossingcommunity.org on our website today. So if you guys can stand as we pray for opening of our church service this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you for this time that we could all come to your house, Lord Jesus, to worship you, to learn more about you, to grow closer to you, Lord Jesus. And I pray right now, Lord Jesus, that you would be with Pastor Nick as he's doing this work for Life Choices. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would just bless him and you would just encourage the people that are hearing his message this morning, Lord Jesus, and that the Holy Spirit would just move. And we pray right now for that as well for our service, Lord Jesus, that you would just come, that you would just fill us with your presence, Lord Jesus, that you would meet each one of us right where we're at right now as we prepare our hearts to worship you, Lord Jesus. We pray all of this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Psalms 19:7 says, "The instructions of the Lord are perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple." Please remain standing as we worship the Lord this morning.
Jesus at the center of Our church family verse of the week this week is 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 30 through 31. And we want to encourage you to join our church family this week in memorizing and praying through this verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 31 says, God has united you in Christ Jesus. For our benefit, God has made him to be wisdom itself. Christ has made us right with God. He has made us pure and holy and freed us from sin. Therefore, as the scriptures say, if you boast, boast only about the Lord.
So this is the time of the service that we're going to pray for pray for Mr. Dave as he's going to share with us this morning. And then also I want everybody to know that You can share with us your prayer needs and concerns, either through the Connect card on the back side of the Connect card in the foyer over here in the hallway. You can put your prayer concerns and needs and put them in there, and Pastor Nick will pray and the leadership team will pray for your needs and concerns. And people online, you can either let us know those needs and concerns on our website at www.hopecrossingcommunity.org, or on our Facebook page, you can list them there, and then we will be happy to pray for you. Right now, if our kids that are like kindergarten through fifth grade, if they could stand right now as we can pray for you and your teacher before we dismiss you to kids' church. If everybody could just extend your hands. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray that you would just be with Miss Lynn right now and our children, Lord Jesus, our Hope kids, and we pray that you would just bless them and encourage them and their teacher, and that they would learn to love you and grow closer to you and learn to love others. And we pray all these things in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. And then, Mr. Dave, if you want to come up here, I'll pray for you real quick. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray right now that you would be with Mr. Dave, Lord Jesus. We pray that you would, the Holy Spirit would just come, that the message that he's about to give to each one of us, Lord Jesus, we pray that we would touch each one of us and meet each one of us right where we're at. And we pray that it would be a wonderful service. And we pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I got the big boy mic on this morning. It's kind of unusual. I have to get used to this a little bit. I hope you can hear me all right. Well, my friends, it's always an honor to get to speak with you this in the morning, anytime, to my brothers and sisters in Christ. And I thank you all for putting up with me. I realize, and I'll be the first to admit, that I'm not a pastor, a preacher, a theologian by any means. I'm merely a layman like most of you out there today. And as much as I'd like to be a pastor, it's a bar too high for this kid right now. So I'm just going to do my best as the layman that I am to extend this thought that the Lord has put on my heart. And I want to talk about inadequacy, fear, and God's amazing grace. I do believe that our Christianity is not just a journey, friends, but it is a journey, not just a destination, because some people figure when you get to your destination, when you get to your salvation, everything else is done, and we can just kind of relax. But I believe in my heart that God often invites us to do things far beyond our natural abilities, and even beyond our belief in our own abilities. It's so that we can grow in our understanding of God's amazing character. So, as scary as it is, I will gladly accept Pastor Nick's invitation to speak to you all whenever he has the direction or courage to let me up here. I will answer in the affirmative. But I have to admit that when I got the invitation to speak, and it wasn't that long ago, I need about 2 months to figure out what to say to you guys, and I had about 10 days. So, so when I got that invitation to speak to you, I got to admit that the adrenaline was really running high. It was surging. And I have to admit again that it's not that fun type of adrenaline, like the excitement you might get by saying, woohoo, the Denver Broncos finally won a football game. Okay, that's exciting stuff. But now I'm talking more about that feeling that you get when you lean back in your chair a little too far and you almost go over. That type of adrenaline rush, that kind of takes your breath away. It's a little different than woohoo football game stuff. So when this feeling hit me again, and it does every time, I really had to sit back and dwell on this emotion for a while, try to figure out why I panic like this when all I'm being asked to do is to stand before my friends and speak a little bit, talk to them for a while. I said, can't be that difficult, right? And I believe in my heart that God goes everywhere with me. He doesn't call me to anything that he doesn't join me in. He doesn't go with me. So why? Why the panic? Why do I feel that terror of just talking to my friends about the love of my life, Jesus Christ? It's because I think I'm actually feeling quite inadequate in what I'm being asked to do to the Lord, for the Lord. And under myself, I have to admit again that I really am inadequate, but only when I try to do things on my own without God's help. So we have a long history of people in our community, even in our Bible, that feel the same way, and I really don't feel too badly about that because I'm in really good company. I look in the Bible, and I know I'm in really good company. Maybe you guys can identify with that. Maybe you've been asked to serve the Lord in some way and you felt that feeling of inadequacy, that fear that you weren't going to be able to do right by the Lord, that somehow you were going to fail him, and so maybe you backed out a little bit. I do that. I've done that. I probably will do that. And we're going to talk about all that in just a minute. So today, I want to talk to you guys all about how God's strength is made perfect in our weakness. And I count on that. It's all about how God's grace can override our fears and feelings of inadequacies if we simply rest and believe his promises. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8, Paul is telling us about a revelation given to him when he desired God to remove this thorn in the flesh, he called it. And we don't even know what that thorn in the flesh was for Paul. We just know that it was a bother to him. And that he pleaded with God three separate times for the Lord to take it away from him. But Jesus tells Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, Paul goes on to say that I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. Wow, I like the sound of that. I like when my weaknesses bring his strength. So as we study and learn God's holy word in our beloved Bible, we see tons of examples of how God calls and then uses the seemingly least capable of us, the most fearful of us, for his service and ultimately for his glory. So today I'm going to be talking about a few biblical figures, biblical heroes, if you will, that were filled with doubt about their own abilities and usefulness to the Lord to perform his work. Now, these aren't people that they weren't always sure about what God was asking them to do or that they could do it effectively. These are people who listened, even if they were afraid, but ended up trusting God's promises and his provisions in the end. These are people who were victorious because of that trust. All of these people were asked to do things they were almost universally thought was over their heads, ability-wise anyway. You know what? They were right. They were right. Without God's grace, they were powerless. They were impotent. They were just like we are without God's grace. But with his amazing grace, they and we can do anything God wills, especially when we're working in his power, in his will, and for his glory and not our own. So, in no particular order, and please believe me, there's no particular order. I want to make sure this is not greatest to least or vice versa, just the way it came to me. First on our list this morning is Moses. Now, y'all know Moses. You've heard about him a lot of times. You spend any time in the Holy Word at all. In Exodus 3, we learn that God is preparing to send Moses into Egypt to free his children from slavery. God tells Moses that he intends to send him and that he will be successful. He gives Moses the rundown, the whole thing of his plan. And immediately, Moses starts complaining. Immediately, he starts looking for a way out. How human. Who am I that I should go? He asks. God tells Moses, relax. I'm going with you. He continues, who am I? I don't even know your name, Moses complains. God tells Moses that I am is the one who sends you. Moses continues, what if they don't believe me or listen to me. Moses is given three separate ways that God will prove that he was sent there by Yahweh. His wooden staff, that is Moses' wooden staff, right, will turn into a snake and then back into a wooden staff. His healthy hand turns white and leprous and looks like it's about to die. And God brings it back to health right in front of him. And if he needs another act to further convince the Egyptians, the water that Moses will draw from the Nile River will turn to blood as he pours it out on the sand. But that still isn't enough for homeboy Moses to go. He still complains. He says, I don't speak well. I'm not eloquent. I'm slow of speech. I'm slow of tongue. Oh, our Lord. Can't you just hear him sigh right about now? Can't you just see him shaking his head? I mean, oh, what a mighty patient God we worship. The God's starting to get a little bit angry here with Moses. And it's a righteous anger, to be sure, but he's still merciful to Moses. And he tells Moses to take his brother Aaron with him when he goes to allow God to speak to Moses, who will speak to Aaron, who will speak to the people. That's about a patient, generous God in my mind. And we need to remember that when God sends us or brings kingdom-serving opportunities to us, he always goes with us. He will speak through us. Praise God. He will accomplish his goals by using us. So don't worry about how he's going to use you. Don't worry about what you're going to say in that time. Just go. His grace is sufficient for us. Just go. Be courageous. Go with him. Watch him make you victorious in his name. Well, number two on our list this morning is Joshua. After Moses' death, Joshua became the leader of Israel. And I think you can see that he had some really big shoes to fill here. It was now up to him to lead the nation of Israel into the promised land. And if you remember, the nation of Israel was not tiny. These were not a ragtag little band of people, a few dozen folks. We're talking 2 to 3 million people. This was quite a group. And to be the leader of them, oh my goodness, staggering thought. And we don't know exactly how how Joshua felt about this, but we do know that God spent an inordinate amount of time talking with him, instructing and encouraging Joshua's heart. We know that he had to be a little concerned about following in Moses' footsteps. The Lord took all this time. It was needed. There was a lot of work to be done. An enormous amount of work awaited him. But even as Joshua's own spies came back to him, and they returned reports of impossibilities and sure failure going ahead, Joshua put away his fears, trusted God's grace instead of his men's fears, and was indeed successful in leading the nation of Israel into the promised land as God had promised that he would. It's a really exciting story, and I hope you'll take time to read about it in the book of Joshua. It's really exciting stuff. Well, number three in our list this morning is Gideon. Gideon was a young man working on his father's farm when Jesus showed up sitting under an oak tree, watching him work. Now, scripture at this point refers to Jesus as the angel of the Lord. Here. Now, again, I'm not a theologian, but I have been taught, and I believe that when the Bible states an angel of the Lord, it's referring to a member of God's heavenly host, his army. But when it states the angel of the Lord, it's actually referring to Jesus himself. Scripture here refers to him as the angel of the Lord here in the book of Judges. This is the Old Testament. We have to remember that they had not met the man Jesus yet. They really didn't know him. But he shows up as the angel of the Lord. And as soon as Jesus tells Gideon that the Lord is with you, Gideon starts complaining. He complains about how tough things are. He complains about how God has abandoned the nation of Israel. So Jesus tells Gideon straight up, then you go save the nation. Pretty straightforward. I mean, not asking much, right? Gideon's reply in Judges 6:15, he says, pardon me, Lord, but how can I save Israel? my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. It seems that the tribe of Manasseh at this time was also considered the least of the tribes of Israel. So poor Gideon here really must have been feeling like a bottom dweller, at least of the least of the least. But he's told that by the Lord that he will not go alone. I will go with you. Jesus tells him personally. Does that sound familiar? I mean, are we starting to see a repetition here? You've read it in the Bible so many times. It's a phrase repeated throughout the Bible. I will be with you. We got to count on that. But what was Gideon's response to Jesus right here? He tells God Almighty to prove it. Oh, prove it. That's a pretty gutsy move if you ask me. I mean, I'm not sure that was really wise. Jesus reminded us in Matthew 4:7, that's never a good idea to tempt God, to test him. But our merciful God does indeed test him. He does prove it. In a really amazing way, too. You should read this. Gideon went on to demonstrate God's amazing power as he led the Israelite army against an overwhelmingly large Midianite army using just a bare minimum of soldiers. God kept cutting down the numbers till there was hardly any going against the Midianites. But that was God's plan. He did it all for his glory. And it's such a great story, guys. Take a minute to read that in the book of Judges. You'll be amazed at how God works through Gideon. Next is Peter. Peter, we know Peter. He was once named Simon until the Lord renamed him. Peter was one of Jesus' apostles. He had spent the better part of 3 years accompanying Jesus in, as our Lord performed miracle after miracle, taught and preached God's amazing love for us. But even then, even after being present for nearly all of Jesus' earthly ministry, even after pledging his own life to Jesus, fear and unworthiness still overwhelmed him. Peter was desperate on the night of Jesus' arrest. And just like Jesus had foretold Peter in Matthew 26:75, that Peter did indeed deny Jesus 3 times before the rooster crowed. Yet even in this moment of fear, even in this moment of terror, these would be erased by God's Holy Spirit at Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came upon Peter. God's power and grace turned this timid, fearful fisherman into a mighty force proclaiming God's glory and mercy to a, let's face it, we're a desperately wicked world still, even to the day. And finally, we come to Paul, my friends. Paul, we all know Paul. Paul was an apostle of Jesus Christ. He was not, however, one of the 12 disciples. Now, he came into the picture after Jesus' death and resurrection and became an apostle. An apostle is simply one who is sent. It means a messenger. He was definitely a messenger for the Lord. You've heard a lot about Paul. He was the most prolific author in the Bible. He wrote somewhere either 8 or 13 books of the New Testament. It depends on who you ask. There's some conversation about that. So you could hardly call Paul a lifelong follower of Jesus. And you might remember, before Paul became Paul the Apostle, he was referred to as Saul. In Acts 13:9, we find that he's no longer called Saul, and Saul meaning to ask questions, but he's now referred to as Paul, which means humble. It seems these two names were used interchangeably at the time, kind of like we use William and Bill or whatever. The Jewish lawyers of the time were called Pharisees. These were the keepers of the Jewish law. Now, Saul was considered a Pharisee of Pharisees. In fact, that's what he considered himself. That's his own description of himself in the Bible. A Pharisee of Pharisees. He was a true zealot for Judaism. His passion truly was to purge the blasphemous followers of the way from the face of the earth. Now, that's what the faith in Jesus was called at the time. It was called the way. And it wasn't until Saul found himself knocked to the ground by the Lord as he made his way to Damascus, he was going there to seek even more Christians to persecute. Well, the Lord knocks him to the ground, and he reprimands him in a most pointed way. He was blinded. He was healed, filled with the Holy Spirit, and baptized all on the same day. Busy guy. God's amazing grace can fix any wayward heart. We see that in the story of Saul / Paul. So Saul was sent out to proclaim Jesus as Lord of all. All across Asia Minor, all the way to Rome. And Rome was considered the capital of the civilized world. And there's some discussion about whether he sent his messengers on to as far away as Spain. You can't get much farther than that and stay in Europe. Now, these men that we're speaking about today, they're all men of distinctions. But even for Saul, when he was renamed or recalled Paul, he was desperately humble. He had to have felt his own worth. These people were weak, fearful, just like you and me. They were just normal people, ordinary people, going through their lives the best way that they knew how. When God decided that they would be used by him in extraordinary ways just to accomplish his will and his purpose. And sometimes they seem to doubt God as much as they trusted him, and that seems to still be the case for some of us today, and I know I'm guilty. Sometimes they followed God's way, and sometimes, well, they demanded their own way. These are hardly men to be celebrated unto themselves. But in the end, each one of them ended up following God, and their missions were victorious, and they were crucial for God's plan and purpose. So what was it? What made the difference in their lives? What made the difference in their hearts and their actions? Yeah, God's amazing grace. All of our feelings of inadequacy, fear, trepidation can be erased by God's amazing grace. I've seen it enough. See, God's in the transformation business. That's what he does. He changes hearts. He changes minds. He changes lives. And we can take courage in that, just like the people written throughout our Holy Bible. Because God promises to go with us wherever he sends us. Even if it seems to be too small a task that it would even make a difference in the kingdom. Even if that task seems too big to even accomplish. See, no opportunity is too small or too big to serve God. He's got a purpose. He's got a plan. Trust him. He can use the smallest, most seemingly benign service, or even a statement to do great works for him. It was only a few months ago I stood up here and I relayed a story to you guys about an event. My wife and I went to the hospital. We were there to visit a friend. A lady in the elevator asked us if we were there to visit a friend, and we said yes, and she asked us how the friend was doing. I replied, yes, better, praise God, which quickly led to a praiseful time of worship and prayer right there in the lobby of the hospital. Three little words, praise God, yes, praise God. And he just used it to bless us all, and who knows who else that we don't even know about, but we know that we were blessed. My point then, as now, is to show how God can use even three small words, the smallest effort on our parts, to stir the hearts and stir the faith of others, all to his glory. And see, grace can soften the hardest heart. It did it to all these biblical heroes in the Bible. He used grace. He transformed them. He gave them the desire, the power, and the wisdom to do extraordinary things for him, things they would not have been able to do without God's amazing grace. Now, grace, as we find out, grace is actually defined as meaning unmerited favor. That's favor that you and I don't deserve. We don't deserve, but God offers it to us anyway. Unmerited favor. This is the favor that says when God calls you, God always goes with you, supplying whatever you need to accomplish the task he has sent you to do. Now, these men of renown that we just talked about, they were not particularly special. Ask them, they'll tell you. But they were transformed. They were changed, transformed by God's amazing grace. Transformed to trust God's promises, trust his provision, to trust him when he chooses to call them into service. The trust that we need as he calls us into service. So I guess, you know, ultimately, that's why I accepted Pastor Nick's invitation to speak with you today. I'm not eloquent, but I am very much in my service of season of service to the King, I put it. And I simply don't want to miss any opportunities that he brings to me. I want him to lead my way. I consider this here today another opportunity to grow, to become a better disciple, and to learn to trust my Lord Jesus when he tells me that his power will be shown in my weakness. I definitely need his strength. And after all that Jesus did for us, anything he asks of us is a very small thing to do, I think you'll agree. With his anointing, we can do anything he calls us to do. So my message to you this morning, my friends, indeed my hope for you this morning, is that we can all be courageous and serve our God in any way he asks us to. Courageous. We serve him regardless of whether we feel adequate or skilled enough. You can't rely on those judgments, not those self-judgments. We serve him even when we feel scared, weak, or powerless. Especially when we feel scared, weak, or powerless. Allow him, allow the Lord to show his strength through you. Not just to you, but through you to others. When responding to God's call on our lives, we are indeed the strongest through Christ Jesus when we feel weakest in ourselves. So my friends, be courageous. Be transformed. Be courageous in the Lord. Watch him do mighty things through you. Be courageous and see what he does. Thank you so very much, my friends. I thank you so very much for this time to speak with you this morning. Would you please all stand with me now as we share one more song together and praise to our King before we end our time together this morning. Thank you so very much, friends.
Couple more reminders before we dismiss today. You can give online on our website at www.hopecrossingcommunity.org, or there's envelopes in the hallway and a basket out there for your tithes and offerings, or we have a drop box in the entryway on the north side of the church, and you can drop it off anytime during the week, day or night. It's a secure box, and you can also do the same for all of your prayer needs, like I mentioned two other times during the service. Just remember this week, like Mr. Dave said, we all need God's grace, and we're all adequate and courageous through God's grace. So how will you serve your Lord this week? So either join us here or online or on Facebook or on YouTube next week. Be praying for you. So have a great week. Thank you.